Welcome back to Let's Play Enderal, Forgotten Stories, Blind. We're here at the Sun Temple, and I guess that's the machine that they, that we took out of old Dothelgrad, is what's humming. Calia will be relieved to hear that Jesper and I safely arrived in Enderal. I should speak with her once I have the chance to. I can probably find her in the temple. And we safely returned to Enderal. Jesper already went back to the Sun Temple. I should go there as well and report our survival to Aranthiel and the others. Yeah, that's a quest from Duneville. Yeah, some tough quests around Duneville. We'll get there eventually. Oh, yeah. Just reminding myself that's up by Frostcliff Tavern or somewhere around there. Gargantua. Yeah. Alright, so they're both. That's Aranthiel. Kalia's over here. Let's go talk to Calia first. She's out. It looks like she's out walking around. She's outside here somewhere. She's back over here. Hi!
Saira, good to see you. I heard about what happened on Half Moon Island. It's a wonder you and that mercenary made it back alive.
Half Moon Island.
But war, it just seems so unreal.
Oh yeah.
How has it come to this? Now we not only have to fight these high ones, but also some fanatic who thinks he knows best?
Mm. Oh, there's a delay. Korok seems so convinced that what he's doing is right. It's almost as if the High Ones are using him.
If they are, then maybe we were foolish to think that the Red Madness is the only weapon at their disposal. Tell me, Saira, how is it possible that our beliefs about what's best for mankind are so different? Why are we so eager to be at each other's throats?
'Cause people stink. Yeah, that's pretty much my answer there. Violence often seems like an easy answer. Yeah, both, actually. This is a little less depressing. Violence often seems like an easy answer, particularly if times are hard, as they are right now.
Suffering leads to more suffering. Yes, that makes sense. You know what I find so hard to understand? Why there are so few people who actually care. So few feel the need to change something like you and I do. There are moments I just feel so powerless. As if we all know that if we keep going like this, we're headed for a catastrophe. But instead of changing course, we just stand by and watch.
Yeah.
Do you know the feeling?
You mean you don't understand why so many people are so disinterested?
Yes. I mean, is it so hard to see that this world could be such a better place if we'd only care a tiny bit more about something other than what's happening in front of our doorsteps? You understand what I'm trying to say, don't you? You know that feeling, too.
Absolutely. I do, yes, but I stopped agonizing over it.
I wish I could do that. Whenever I think about it, I find it so hard not to get angry. Take all those upper city snobs with their colorful garments and exotic perfumes. They could put all that money to such good use if only they wanted to, but no, they don't. Because they just don't give a damn about the poor. Sometimes I imagine going down there, grabbing one of them by the collar, and dragging them down into the Undercity. and there I'd force them to see, just for once. But even that probably wouldn't help. I guess
maybe.
We only care about the things that directly affect us. Who fights against poverty if he's never suffered from it?
You do, and that's admirable.
No, it's not. It should be what everyone does.
But unfortunately it isn't.
And once again, you've had to listen to another deluge of my whining.
Oh no.
I guess I'm just not a person for pleasantries. Sorry.
Don't be. I actually think the world could use more people like you.
Anyway, I need to make some preparations now. Master Bartar requested my support with something, and I shouldn't keep him waiting any longer.
Yes.
Yes?
Thou art my light, my glimmer at the horizon. Thy name is my sacrament, and thy path I will honor in life as in death.
If you don't know your parents, how did you come by your name, Calia?
It was stitched into the blanket they found me in near that village. I don't really know if it is my actual name, but I had nothing else to go with. So it stuck.
Why is it that you always say Karash? Isn't that Kyranian?
Yes, it is. Master Tyrus, my foster father. He was half Kyranian, as you might have guessed already. Some words just stuck around.
Okay. What's the story behind your tattoo?
Tattoo? Oh, of course, you mean my mark.
Yeah.
I've had that for as long as I can remember. And I don't have the slightest idea as to how I got it.
Wow. Is it, I don't know, magical?
No, it isn't. It's just there, that's all.
If it's any comfort to you, it looks pretty cool.
It does. You're the first to tell me that, but thanks, I guess.
You're welcome, I guess. Well, something like that just doesn't appear out of nowhere. Someone must have put it on you.
That's what Tyrus said, too. But if it has a meaning, it's obscure. I couldn't find anything in the books, and the magisters couldn't put their fingers on it either.
Can't you remove it somehow?
Not without leaving a bad scar, at least according to the apothecary.
Right.
And even if that weren't the case, I don't know if I'd want it gone. It reminds me of something.
What do you think about the current events?
Until that Quarik appeared, I actually thought things were going relatively well, like with the sigil stone and this beacon. But a war with Nareem? That changes everything. They trump us in every aspect. Manpower, equipment, siege machinery. Let's just hope the walls of Ark are really as durable as they're said to be.
Huh. We might find out. You seem to spend a lot of time on your own. Was it always like that?
Well, as I told you, I was never very popular with the other novices. You know, the noviciate was very challenging. The magisters only rarely gave us days off to contemplate, as they called it. The others usually used it to go to the tavern to gamble and drink. I never really liked that kind of pastime, and I still don't.
What about love? That's a good enough pastime.
I've never really thought about things like that. You know, life in the temple is quite secluded.
Right.
And I doubt there are many men or women who would find my way of living attractive. But forgive me, that's very personal. I don't really want to talk about it.
Okay. Well, everyone needs to stretch their legs from time to time, also.
That's true, but when I feel the need to relax, I prefer taking a stroll or spending time in the baths. Whatever secret there is about relaxing to loud music, raucous shouting, and alcohol is beyond me.
I totally get that. I have some questions about the entity inside you, if that's okay. The it, as you call it.
If it's really necessary. What do you want to know?
What happened in old Dothograd with that bandit? Has that happened before?
If that were the case, I probably wouldn't be here right now, would I? No, it hasn't.
No.
Usually it's just thoughts. And they're almost always there. It's as if there's always something lurking in the dark corners of my mind, just waiting for me to give in. It's tough, to say the least. I don't know if you can relate to that.
I'm trying. So if you were to actually give in to this thing, what would happen? Would you transform?
Honest answer? I don't know, and I don't want to know. As I told you in the Scuola, if I really am the one to blame for that massacre in the village, if this memory is real, then the answer to your question is yes. I would transform into whatever this creature is, but it will never come to that. You have my word.
Really hesitant to ask her this, because I have a feeling it would offend her. Yeah, that would be a stupid thing to say in light of what she's just told us. Why is this thing burdening you so much? You might transform into something else. Oh no, that's... I'm not gonna say that to her. Well, I'm off to find out what the weird humming is. And perhaps you are as well. And to talk to Aranthiel. Is she coming this way? No. Alright.
Greedy?
Nope. Don't do that to me.
Walk blessed.
In or out, lady?
Walk blessed.
Where the hell am I going?
Let's hope he knows what he's doing.
You just wait and see. She doesn't know where she's going, what she's doing. Okay. Any younger.
Yes.
Looks like it's in here. The Emporium. She might have already been in the Emporium, but this is more Emporium then.
But that's ridiculous. We have to at least try to negotiate.
No more arguments.
You know his demands. There's no basis for negotiation.
He has not seen what we have seen. The writings, the memories of the prophetess.
Move.
If he just realized.
My dams? My sirs?
Shit. What took you so long? And where is Constantine?
That's a long story.
And those were his final words.
I can move now. Okay.
I can't believe it.
Simply another victim of the High Ones. If we do not activate the beacon soon, he won't be the last.
Oh, right. The beacon. If it's activated, we'll simply glow the red madness away, won't we? Or maybe we could, for once in all this, do something that actually makes sense and focus our resources on finding an alchemistical or thaumaturgical solution to this problem rather than trusting in a pile of scrap metal.
Oh, by the prophet's ass, won't you just shut up for a minute?
Tell her.
You do nothing but babble, getting on our nerves, and nothing you ever say gets any closer to a fucking solution.
Right on.
So why don't you just shove off to one of the bathhouses? Go torture the washerwomen with your never-ending lamentations.
Woo!
That would be helpful for a change.
You will take that back.
Don't take it back.
Will I? Come here and make me. I'd be delighted.
Oh, wow.
Guard your tongue,
this is blasphemy.
Wild mage, or...
Or what? Are you gonna kill me? That's what you do best, you and your fucking order.
Silence!
Whoa.
You are angry, Lishari Pegas.
No kidding.
And I understand why. But in the moment you let that anger destroy this alliance, Firespark's sacrifice will have been in vain. Is that what you want? Is that what you want?
No, it isn't.
Good. I am tired of this endless bickering. We have a responsibility, and we will fulfill it.
Well said, Aranthiel. And how exactly do you think we are going to do that? Without the sources, the beacon is as worthless as a heap of rusty iron.
The chroniclers are on it, and they will find the answer.
The chroniclers?
Novice, tell Commander Aaron to join us. We need to plan the defense of the land. You, Prophetess, will speak to me as soon as you have recovered. Now, let us get to work.
I'm recovered.
Please, Tealor, Jorik is right. A war with Nerin? This is madness.
I know that it is going to be tough. We have no choice. The beacon is all that we have.
Yes, the beacon. The beacon. The beacon. We don't even know what this thing does, let alone if it will work. If you start a war only because of that damn machine, it means putting the lives of thousands at risk, only because of some vague idea. This is ludicrous, Tealor. It's entirely irrational. The man I knew would never have acted like this.
Yes, because that man is dead. I've made decisions driven by fear and selfishness before, and they were always wrong. I will not let that happen again. Seriously, Natara, stop acting as if this were about reason. You're just afraid of making sacrifices for what you believe in.
Sorry.
You always were.
Sacrifices? This is about your damn pride, Tealor. Nothing else.
I was trying to ask you a few things. Sorry.
What?
The Grandmaster. Have I asked him this before? You two seem to know each other well, right?
Well, I suppose you could say that, yes. Natara, Tealor, and I passed our novitiate together.
So the three of you all joined the Order at the same time?
You make it sound as if the Order is some kind of mercenary guild. You don't join the Order. You're chosen for it.
Pardon you?
Both Aranthiel and I come from a bloodline older than the stones of this temple. It was our path to become keepers, and we followed it. It wasn't much of a choice.
Hmm. So just you and Aranthiel, then? What about the Chuchessa?
That's a different story, and not one for today.
What day, then? How about you? You don't exactly seem ready to burst with gladness about my consecration, either.
Should I? I don't know if you deserve to be here. Sakharesh does. She has proven it for close to 10 years now. But you...
But me?
Maybe there is something to the Grandmaster's talk about you being one of these emissaries, and maybe you can indeed help us in some way. But you're still an outsider. No matter which crest you wear on your armor, that won't change.
When can I be an insider? Oh, he's leaving. He doesn't want to wait for me anymore, but... So I already reported him. Didn't he want to talk to me? No, it says leave the Emporium.
The sun be praised, you've made it.
I was wondering where you were.
Constantine. He didn't deserve this.
No.
It's just not fair.
Yeah, I miss him. He acted as if he was possessed. Maybe his mind was not strong enough for all of this? I think it was, though, but... He did act as if he was possessed.
Then none of us are strong enough. Yeah, Constantine wasn't exactly the most approachable fellow, but he was a damn skilled mage.
Agreed.
I have to talk to you as soon as possible. It's about the seal in that letter we found on the mercenaries in old Rashengrad.
We're talking now.
I believe I'm onto something.
Okay, well?
Their client is from Enderal. From Ark, to be more precise.
Oh.
Let's not talk here, though. Meet me in the Dancing Nomad.
Okay.
I'll be in the first room upstairs, right at the end of the staircase. And hurry.
Why so secretive?
Well, why do you think? Come to the Dancing Nomad after you've spoken with Aranthiel. See you there. Now look at that. It's the prodigy.
Something tells me I might have asked her this before, maybe in Old Rationgrad. Any ideas how this machine is supposed to help us against the cycle?
Question of the century. Honestly, I don't know. We might as well be chasing a phantasm. But at this point, it seems to me that the beacon is some kind of channeling device. Sounds confusing, I know. But it reacts very strongly to any magically charged object. But as to how this will serve us against the High Ones, that remains to be seen.
A channeling device. But what does it channel? Magical energy? Or something else? Well, okay, see you at the Dancing Nomad then. It says to leave the Emporium. Find Aranthiel too. Wherever he might be. He's up here. And he might be leaning against the railing. This is the first time I talked to him, really. He's up here. Oh, they have it set up over there? Meet Tealor Aranthiel at the beacon and confront Aranthiel with his dispute with the Chuchessa. Lashari Pegas claims she has found a clue to the person behind the mercenary attack on Old Rationgrad. She wants me to meet her in a Dancing Nomad after Aranthiel briefed me about our further options. Wow. Sorry, it's quite an impressive looking device. What was that about? Your argument with Natara in the Emporium?
Irrelevant. This madman,
Kowarek,
he has completely reshuffled the cards. Now we not only have to deal with the High Ones, but also with him and his fanatics. However, there's also good news. You have probably seen it already.
You managed to reconstruct the beacon?
Physically, yes. And we also know how it works now, and how it can put an end to the cycle.
Really? How?
It is easier than we thought. The beacon was constructed for one thing, to destroy the High Ones. Once reconstructed, infused with energy and activated, lit, as the Pyreans called it, it can banish the High Ones from this plane of existence.
Wow. Destroy them? How is it supposed to work? The High Ones are...
immaterial, indeed. Essentially, they can be compared to the cold or to shadows. Omnipresent elements, yet we cannot touch them. Energy, if you will. However, there is a counterpart to each energy.
Right.
Cold and fire, shadow and light. The High Ones and the beacon.
So you mean that the beacon is some kind of counterpart to what the High Ones are?
Yes. Imagine a torch driving away the darkness in the moment it is ignited. This is what the beacon can do, except that the banishing will be permanent.
That sounds good. So what's keeping us from lighting it? Sharim mentions sources?
Yes, as I said, it needs to be infused with energy before it can be lit.
What energy?
I take it you have noticed the three sockets on its base. They are what it draws its power from.
Didn't really love
it. Once they are filled, the beacon can be ignited and the High Ones will be undone, once and for all. At least, if the old writings are true. The only thing left for us to find out is what these energy sources are. But we are close.
Mm.
Give the Arcanists some more time and I will let you know if there's any news. In the meantime, get equipped accordingly. Some of the Neremes have landed already, and outbreaks of the Red Madness become more and more frequent as we speak.
Great. So more insane people and more people and things attacking us. I have a sneaking feeling that the energy we is like living like a life force, like we have to sacrifice people, probably people with great power to, you know, can't just drag like a highwayman or something. It's probably going to have to sacrifice somebody with great power, or three people with great power. That's could be heartbreaking, especially depending on who it might have to be. Well, there's three of us, too. Right? Me, Tealor, and the Trichessa? Or the other guy, Tealor, and the Trichessa. The guy I just talked to. I forget what his name is. Is there nothing we can do against the Red Madness? By the way, guys, just don't say a word, whether I'm right or wrong. Just, I'm thinking out loud. No spoilers, please. Is there nothing we can do against the Red Madness? Distribute some of the Sigil Stone's shards among the people, maybe?
No, there are not enough.
Yeah.
And we must keep the few there are in our possession, in case anything unexpected should happen. The only thing we can do to stop the madness is to destroy the High Ones as soon as possible.
Right. The Chuchessa mentioned something about what happened in Kyra, or Kira. What did she mean by that?
Well, it's only fair to tell you. You've always been honest to me, so I will do the same. Have you ever heard of the Night of the Thousand Fires?
No. Okay, vaguely.
Between 8192 and 8202, there was an underground movement in Kira called the Red Half Moon.
Okay.
They were brought into being by a group of intellectuals and philosophers who, under all the freedom of thought Saldrin granted them, started questioning the reign of the Golden Queen, and thus the Lightborn themselves.
Freedom of thought that Saldrin granted them? What do you mean by that?
Saldrin saw himself as the god of knowledge, and accordingly he reigned his country. In Kira, no opinion is forbidden, which is why it is home to countless magic schools and universities, where people do nothing but discuss the reason for being all day long. An appealing thought if you hear it for the first time, but a cunning people isn't easy to rein. There have been more revolts and riots in Kira than bones in a graveyard, and the Red Half Moon was the worst of them.
So this Red Half Moon tried to end the reign of the gods just as your son did, correct?
Correct. Just as my son did. But other than him, they fought like cowards.
Oh.
Terror, dust crystals planted in the marketplaces, and assassinations, you name it. If they killed innocents, they blamed the Golden Queen. And if they killed her soldiers, they celebrated themselves as liberators.
Convenient.
However, they never succeeded in putting her down, and neither did she in destroying them, which is why the court turned to the Lightborn for help. A division of the Holy Order led by me, a young keeper of barely 30 winters.
Why did you have to come all the way from Enderal? Didn't the Order have a bastion on Kira?
None to be taken seriously. You know, not everywhere is the Order as present as here on Enderal, or as it once was on Narim. In Kira, we were ridiculed. I saw the Kyranian keepers who served the Golden Queen. A bunch of decadent gluttons who had dedicated themselves to the court's banquets rather than to the will of the gods. They were pathetic.
Sounds it. So, what happened?
A moon after our arrival, we received an anonymous tip on where one of the half-moon's bases was supposed to be located, in a small coastal village. As we entered it, we were greeted by the township's elders, and the villagers themselves had gathered behind them. You should have seen how they stared at us, as if we were plunderers. I should have seen by then that something was wrong.
Why did the villagers fear you? Didn't they know that you had been sent by their queen?
Yes, but if there was one thing the Red Half Moon was good at, it was sowing lies. According to them, we were nothing but butchers who executed everyone unable to recite the revelation word for word.
Wow. So let me guess, the entire thing was a trap?
That's what they wanted us to think, and they did a good job at that. A veiled person here, an archer on the rooftops there. I got nervous, because villagers are not, they bested us in numbers, and they had kettled us.
Kettled you?
Then a man seemed to charge at us, and I gave the order to draw weapons. It was just the spark they needed.
It came to a fight then?
No, not a fight. A massacre. The villagers had pitchforks and shepherd staffs, and we had shadow steel swords, let alone the fact that we were trained warriors. I realized that I had made a mistake a split second after it started, but it was too late by then. My men, they slaughtered them all, like pigs. At the end of the day, 300 people were dead, and only 10 of them were keepers.
Wow. You couldn't do anything at all to stop the fight?
Have you ever been in a big battle? Even if my men would have stopped, the villagers were blinded with rage and panic. No. From the moment I gave the order, it was too late.
Alright. So the Red Half Moon set all of this up. But why? Why would they want an entire village slain?
Well, what better proof of the Lightborn's cruelty is there than a division of keepers who, out of pure wickedness, slaughtered an entire village, women, children included? If the people had already distrusted us before that, that distrust had turned into hatred, and nothing could have changed that, not even the Golden Queen's heralds. We set sail back to Enderal a week later. 2 years after that, the Red Half Moon destroyed itself due to infighting. Ironic, isn't it?
Well, yeah. Well, you panicked in the heat of the moment. You're just trying to be, you know, not be butchered yourself, and things got out of control. There's no shame in that.
Maybe. The Lightborn and the Grandmaster back at that time showed the compassion I wouldn't grant myself. But I learned one thing, and that is that I will never again let fears about my own life influence my decisions. What happened in Kira was the consequence of my own cowardice and my unwillingness to give my life for a just cause. That will never happen again.
Well, if you had given your life at that point, you wouldn't be here to help us now. And we need your help right now. There is something I need to tell you, though. Back on the Half Moon Island, the High Ones told me something there.
What?
Tyrannor Korik sees himself as one of the emissaries, too. The Messiahs.
Really? That's interesting. Provided this is true, that means that the emissaries aren't just people who fight the cleansing. They are people who fight for it too.
Right.
And that also means that whoever granted us our powers and our purpose isn't an enemy of the High Ones, but a neutral party.
Not necessarily. The High Ones also said that Korrig is wrong, and he isn't really an emissary, and neither are you.
I beg your pardon?
Just a messenger. According to the High Ones, Korrig only thinks himself an emissary because he wants to feel important.
What? And the same goes for me? That's ridiculous. They wanted to deceive you, to sow discord. I saw the threat the cleansing posed before anyone else did. And without me, we would have never come that far. Something changed inside me since I fled from my prison. I feel it. And it is the same thing that made you a part of all this. Now, enough of this.
Well, wait.
Prophetess.
I want to tell him about the ask him about the Veiled Woman.
Really? Provided this is true, and that also means that whoever granted us our powers and our purpose isn't an enemy of the High Ones, but a neutral party.
Could this Veiled Woman I told you about be that third party? Or maybe a part of it?
Possibly. But we will find out all about that once we've taken care of the High Ones.
Maybe.
Now, with the Neremese against us, too, there's only one thing that matters. Resolve. We must not hesitate and allow anything to delay the lighting of the beacon any further. Yes?
I asked him this about the cycle.
Yes.
Pretty sure I talked to him about these things. These visions I have, the echo of the future, how exactly does it work? I might ask this too, I don't remember.
As I said before, my knowledge about that is limited. But if it helps you, imagine that it is a way of perceiving that which connects us all, our subconscious.
You mean the place your dreams come from, the collective subconscious of mankind?
Yes. You know, most people perceive themselves as an entity separate from the rest of the world.
I remember now.
And while this is partially true, there is something that connects us. Dark corners of our mind. Bridges to which we in a conscious state do not have access to. But you do not need to be supernaturally gifted to feel that these bridges exist. I am sure you have experienced it yourself at one time or another. A moment where you knew exactly what another person thought or would do next. People with close blood ties can especially feel that connection. Children and their mothers, siblings, and especially twins.
So you're saying that all humans are connected? Yeah, I do remember this conversation now.
Correct. And while most people hardly feel this connection at all, as if looking through a tinted window, to you, it is wide open during your visions.
If that's the case, how do you explain that I can see memories of the Pyreans, too? They have been dead for millennia.
Their bodies might be, but the traces they left behind still remain. Everything that was, everything that is, and everything that will be, it already exists in the sea of eventualities.
Right.
This is the basic principle of magic. And time. Time is not a straight line. Only the barriers of our mind make us perceive it as such.
Are you kneeling on the ground?
Visions, premonitions, dreams that become reality. These are all leftovers of waves from other eventualities that spill over into our reality. There have always been people able to read them, but none so good at it as you are, thanks to the Echo.
Yeah, we're done. Well, I'll talk to you later. Oh, this is where Okay, I see it now. Three things go. Hope you know what you're doing. Okay, so we gotta go talk to... what's her name? Meet Lashari and a Dancing Nomad. That'll be next episode. Kind of a longish episode here, but I'm gonna cut it off. All we did was talk to people, but it was fascinating. So, thanks so much for watching, guys. See you next time, and always, seek adventure.